Hello, I'm Cheryl Capone. I am the co-founder and the artistic director of Capone Art Park here in Eagan. I'm excited about this show here at Artworks Eagan of the early and rarely seen works by my late husband, Anthony Capone, the visionary behind Capone Art Park and the creator of most of the physical work on site and the idea behind it. 2021 would have been his 100th birthday. He passed away 6 years ago. The work in the show here shows the long development of his career as an artist, but also the consistency of his vision. I was a photography student at the university when I met Tony, and I met him through one of his former students who was a professional photographer. I met him in 1978. We were married and together until he passed in 2015. He was 94 when he died. And he worked outside at the art park until he was 92. When Tony came to America, he was 15 years old and he didn't speak any English. And so when they put him in high school classes, they had a very positive bias that an Italian must be an artist. And it just so happened that he was an artist. The art teachers in his high school were really excited to have him in their class. And they did a lot of watercolors and they did some sculpture. When they started to do wood sculpture, you can see the small piece sitting there. The teacher gave him a block of wood, and because his English wasn't very good, he thought he was supposed to come back with the wood carved the next day. He tells this story in the memoir that he wrote quite poetically, and he thought his teacher was just really asking way too much of him. But he came back the next day and he had the small horse finished, and he didn't understand completely at first why his teacher was so upset with him. So they went to the shop class and the teacher asked the instructor there to laminate a very large block of wood that would keep him busy for the rest of the semester. And that's what this other horse and rider is. He did this in 1939. He was 18 years old. When Tony was in high school, one of the things that he loved to do was to do watercolor portraits of people. This one is of his mother, who was his greatest supporter. She didn't understand about art, but she said if her Tony was doing it, it must be good. So she encouraged him to do everything. There were any number of other portraits of people that we could have chosen to put into the show, but this seemed the most appropriate. He loved to do the painting, he loved to do the artwork, but what he really liked was the interaction with the people, that he thought that he was kind of like capturing their essence or their soul in the painting. Like so many other immigrants, his father came to make money and send it back to Italy, and the intention wasn't for the whole family to come, but under Mussolini there weren't any real economic opportunities for Tony. So that's why he came to join his father over here in Italy. Fifth grade was as much schooling as he could get. After that you had to pay for it, and they were peasants. They didn't have the money for it. And then once he was here, then his mother and younger brothers came over also. And he and the older of his other two brothers fought as US GIs in World War II. He was here for all of about 7 years before he got sent back to Italy as an American GI in basic training. He was painting for himself, and one of his generals saw what he did and said, you know, if you don't want to go fight, I can set it up that you can just paint portraits of generals' wives and other people for the whole duration. And that didn't feel very manly to his Italian spirit. So he signed up to be a spy, but the Italian government surrendered just as he was about to be deployed, but the Germans didn't. And so he became an interpreter for the Allied military government. That was one of the groups that worked very closely with the Monuments Men. And one of Tony's jobs was to go around and secure all the important artwork and other valuable places to keep the GIs out so that they wouldn't damage the work. And he also said that that was where being in those museums and up close with all the fine artwork and all the private homes, that was where he got his real education in art. When he came back from the war, he married his high school sweetheart. The Walker Art Center had a school at the time, and so he came to Minnesota to go to school there. And he was there for a short amount of time, and then he transferred to the University of Minnesota. And that's where he got his undergraduate and his graduate degrees in like 3 years. His degree was actually in education as opposed to art, because he knew he was going to be an artist anyway, but the only way that America rewards their artists is by having them teach in college, which gives them some time to do their work. And so he found a job at McAllister right out of school, and he stayed there from 1949 until he retired in 1991. If he had been at the university as opposed to McAllister, which was a private school, probably more people would have known about him, just because there are so many more students that go through the U. This piece here is called Young Bird, and it was one of Tony's favorites, I believe. It sat on the filing cabinet outside his door at McAllister. He told me that he probably could have sold it about 200 times, but he just was not going to let go of it. And it's one of the few pieces where it is actually made out of three different types of stone. A lot of the other pieces that you might see here or that you might see at the park will look like they're multiple stones, but he's just treated the surface differently. Tony was at McAllister from 1949 until he retired in 1991. He was the chair of the department for most of that time. And while he was there, he helped bring art out of the basement and into its own building on campus. And even at the time when the students were demanding that they got rid of all of the requirements for classes, he got changes made so that all the students there were required to take an art class or an art history class to broaden their education so that they had a real liberal arts education. He was responsible for the first art building on any college campus in the country. So this piece, along with many of the other pieces in this show, were created while he was on sabbatical and for a one-man show that traveled the state of Minnesota from the Minnesota Museum of American Art to Rochester Art Center up to the Tweed Gallery. It's called Geological Bundle because it was a large nondescript field stone, and as he carved into it, he discovered all of these different colors in the rock. When one of the geology professors up at the University of Minnesota in Duluth looked at it, he said, "Oh, you brought our rock back to us." Apparently, what he also said was that, you know, this is basalt, but that a rock of basalt had fallen into a pool of red granite that wasn't solidified yet, and so that's why there was the variations in the rock. These are photographs that Tony made in 1975 after spending a sabbatical at his hometown in Italy. It was a small town called Pretare, and it was one of the areas of Italy that was destroyed during the 2016 earthquake. So his home is no longer there. The major town nearby was called Ascoli, and the way to get from one town to the major city was to go on the Via Appia, the Appian Way. And along that way, there was a torrent that went along the side of the road, and there were several little towns along the way. One of those little towns was Favolangiata. So as he was exploring around, there were these high cliffs up above the roadway. As you can see in this photo here, he went and explored and climbed in places that people over there didn't normally climb. But with his sculptor's eye, he went up there and was fascinated by the way the wind and rain had weathered the surface of the relatively soft rock. As you can see in the show, Tony worked in a lot of media, but with the technology of the time, you had to take one photo at a time and hope that you could get them by manipulating them in the dark room to sort of merge or let the eye merge them together. And of course, even any cell phone can do that now. This is one of three pieces here in the show from a series called Reconstructed Anatomy, where Tony was trying to use photography as a new medium and use it in a new way that people hadn't done before. Working from a model rather than showing the photo of the model, he made multiples of parts of the photograph to create these sculptural images. The idea is to take in the design the way it is. You know, can sit there and try to figure out what part of the body it is. Some of them are pretty well transformed. Some are a little bit more obvious. This piece is called Rabbit. Tony made it in 1949 when he was still at the University of Minnesota as a graduate student. And it won the first place award for sculpture at Minneapolis Institute of Art annual exhibit of local artists. The year previous, the Art Institute had purchased one of his sculptures for their permanent collection. Look at this piece and compare it with later ones. You'll see that it still retains all of the sense of it being a stone, and the lines obviously make it into a rabbit. But part of that is because at the time when this was made, he was using hand tools or an electric pneumatic tool, which didn't have the power of the later tools that he had. And being granite, it's very hard to chip away the stone. And so that's why he was working with creating the work by mostly making changes just to the surface of it. You'll see later on, when he has the more powerful tools, he's making holes all the way through the rock. This piece is played out. Tony had a young daughter at that time who was a toddler. She often slept that way, just sort of would just fall over from exhaustion from all of her play. This was made in 1948. It's made out of sandstone, much softer than the granite. So if you were to compare this to the rabbit, you can see that he was able to carve much further into the stone, even though he was using mostly hand tools and an electric pneumatic hammer, which was not as powerful as the later tools that he had. The sculpture is The Family of Man. It was made in 1962. It's a hammered copper, which means that it started out as single 4 by 8 foot sheet of copper that by using hammers and torches and heavy molds to pound against, Tony stretched a flat sheet into this three-dimensional piece. And the inspiration behind this came from the Edward Steichen photo exhibit that was monumental in showing photos of people doing everyday things from all over the world that just really raised people's awareness of photography as an art medium, but also after the horrors of World War II and Korea, trying to get people to start to think about the common humanity. And this was Tony's response to that. So these two sculptures are made out of marble. They're a pair, two sides of man, two sides of woman. And the fun story behind them is not only that Tony would carve from whatever materials were available to him or that somebody gave him, but as chair of the art department at McAllister, he was responsible for, you know, maintaining the building and the gallery and the spaces around it. And he would often get into discussions with administration about how spaces should be used. He wanted to expand the gallery area to include an area that was designated as garden space. And what he wanted to move out of the way were these marble benches that he wanted to clear so that there'd be room for more art exhibitions. So because he wasn't getting anywhere with the administration, he picked up the marble benches and brought them in his studio and turned them into sculptures so that there was no longer a question about what to do with those benches. Tony was born in 1921, which makes this his centenary year. A lot of people in the community don't know Tony well. There was so much of an influence that he had in education and in environmental issues and things. I think he was an important enough contributor to the arts community in Minnesota and to the Egan community that it just seemed like we should celebrate 100 years in his long career.